You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Good morning, welcome to House Baptist Church, and to worship together. days of Elijah.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, preparing the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee. Out of Zion till salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, fields are as wide in your world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Shining like the sun, at the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. So lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Water you turn into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you. Our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you. Our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is greater.
Amen. He's an awesome God, isn't he? Amen. It's good to see you out today. I want to welcome you to Lighthouse Baptist Church here for our morning worship services. And I want to give a hearty, happy Mother's Day to all the ladies, all the mothers that are out there. Had a great early service as well. And we're able to tell the ladies there as well, happy Mother's Day. And we say the same to you. Now, one day, obviously, you know, it doesn't do it justice. Amen. We would not be here literally if it weren't for you. And so we do indeed want to thank you. And just want to share a verse, Proverbs 31, the whole most of the whole chapter speaks about virtuous women. And it says in Proverbs 31:10, who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? And indeed, virtuous woman is definitely a valuable thing, and our mothers indeed are that to us. Abraham Lincoln said, no man is poor who had a godly mother. And we know indeed that the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. Amen. And so indeed they are a treasure. I like what one young boy said. He said, you don't know my mother. A teacher asked the boy this question. Suppose your mother baked a pie and there were 7 of you, your parents and 5 children. What part of the pie would you get? 1/6, replied the boy. The teacher said, I'm afraid you don't know your fraction, said the teacher. Remember, there are 7 of you. He said, yes, teacher, said the boy, but you don't know my mother. My mother would say she didn't want any pie, amen? And that's how a lot of our mothers are, ain't they? They're willing to sacrifice to go without for the good of the rest, and we thank God for them. And so we're so glad to have you today. If you're here visiting today, just hold up your hand for a moment. We have a gift for you. I know I met some folks over here, right over here as well. Good to see you all out. Make sure you hold up your hand there. We got a gift for you. It's a coffee mug with the church's name on it. It's a gift for you. There's a connection card. If you'd be so kind to fill that out, drop it in the offering plate as it comes by here a little bit later, or there's a welcome center, a visitor center out there. You can fill it out there as well. Let's continue to worship the Lord. In just a moment, we'll be in our new series, 1 Thessalonians. You may not be able to spell it, but between now and then, maybe you can find it, all right? 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 in our series today.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ alone, who took on flesh, born as God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. the power of Christ I'll stand. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior,
that you cannot explain,
Have you ever met a stranger who already knew your name? What if it's him? What if it's God speaking? Who knows how he'll get a hold of us, get our attention. Whatever he wants to tell us, I love you. Have you ever lost a loved one who you thought should still be here? Do you know what it feels like to be tangled up in fear? What if he's somehow involved? What if he's speaking through it all? Who knows how he'll get a hold of us, get our attention to prove he is enough. He'll do and he'll use whatever he wants to tell us, I love you. His ways are higher, and his ways are better. Oh, sometimes than God in a manger. Oh, who knows how he'll get a hold of us, get our attention.
Appreciate that song today, Brother Gabe. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 1. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. This is written by Paul, the apostle, to the church at Thessalonica, and he writes these words. We're going to talk in a new series today, Marks of a Healthy Church. Marks of a Healthy Church. Now, this isn't some sort of braggadocious sermon. We don't have it all figured out here. We're not a perfect church. Amen. We know that, but we want to strive to be a healthy church, and I believe we find with the letter to the Thessalonians that Paul tells about how they were a healthy, vibrant church, and we seek to model them, and I believe God has given us a great church here, and we thank him for that. Find your Bibles there, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse number 1. We invite you to stand with us today to honor God's word, and Marks of a Healthy Church is our series. Today, the specific title is A Church is Born. A Church is Born, and what a joy that is. And so in honor of motherhood, we're going to talk about birth, all right? And so we'll look at that in just a moment. But 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 1 down to verse 3 says, Paul and Silvanus and Timothy unto the church of the Thessalonians, which is in God the Father and in the Lord Jesus Christ, Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today, and what a joy it is to be able to come, to gather, to worship you. Lord, we're reflecting today upon the very special and tender role of motherhood. And Lord, as we think on this, Lord, we see, Lord, in your scriptures today about a church that was birthed in Thessalonica, and we know the great sacrifice that went into this work, and we think about the role of mothers today and the great sacrifice that is given that the child may come into this world, and all the rearing of that child and raising and nurturing. And so today we thank you for mothers. Lord, we thank and count ourselves blessed if our mothers are still alive, and if they're not, their legacy still remains. Lord, for the mothers that are here today, may they know how loved they are and how greatly appreciated they are. I pray for anyone today that doesn't know you, that this be the day they come, and God, that we would all understand the great significance and importance your word plays in our lives, and very specifically today, the local church. And Lord, if we're a part of a local church, we know how blessed we are. And if we're not, Lord, may you compel us today to find a local church, a Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching church that is carrying out the Great Commission and seeking to win souls and see people baptized and discipled. Lord, may we find that church and get plugged in and give our lives to that work. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated here today. As we think on this thought, marks of a healthy church, we've been in 1 Peter, and now we move on to 1 Thessalonians, and been praying and seeking the Lord on where to go after we've been in our series, Faith in the Fire. And we come to 1 Thessalonians, and I really felt the Lord just impressing for a number of reasons to come to this section of 1 Thessalonians. We're looking in this series at marks of a healthy church. And as we think about this, you say, why do we study verse by verse and go book by book through the scriptures? Well, let me just say, it's very important that we give ourselves to the reading, hearing, and studying of God's word. Listen, it's the very word of God that is our authority. We don't gather because I'm an authority. We don't gather because we're good people. We gather because God's word is a living book. It is a truthful book. It is what guides us, girds us. It is the entrance of God's word that gives us light. It is what lightens our path along the way. We don't know where to go. We don't know what we should do. But God's word gives us light. It's God's word that regenerates the heart. You're unsaved today. It's the very word of God that will show you your sin, will show you your need of salvation. It is the very word of God that brings about that new birth along with the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit. It is the word of God that not only saves you, but it's the word of God that sanctifies you. It is a work that begins and continues and will complete the work that God's doing in you to make you like Jesus Christ. Oh, dear friend, we have no other reason to stand and declare things. It's not based upon cleverness or intellect. It's not based upon some modern philosophy or program that we can put into place. We come together to worship the Lord as we read, study, and apply God's word to our lives. It will guide us, it will strengthen us, it will gird us up. What other answers does this world have? They have none. They have no answer. The world is in a treacherous position today. Would you say amen today? A treacherous position because the word of God has been ignored. Amos tells us in 8, 11, and 12 that they would wander through the land and be a famine, a time of famine, because it would be a famine of the word of God. And so little is the word of God preached and taught and practiced in people's lives. It is neglected and forsaken. But my friend, in a church that wants to be a church, a local assembly that God is going to bless and honor, they have to uphold the supremacy of the authority of the word of God. So we read the word of God. It isn't just a matter of finding topics. It isn't a matter of finding cute cliches. It isn't finding a few words that seem to fit a sermon or a conversation or some other emotional speech. It is taking God's word. Every word of God is profitable. It is inspired by God. Every word of God is what Jesus used. As said in Deuteronomy 8:3, every word of God is what produces the food. It is the word of God that Jesus used to ward off Satan. So we need to know every word, amen? Jesus didn't attack Satan with his own intellect. He wasn't using some other cliche. He was using the word of God to defend himself from the attacks and assaults from him by Satan. And if Jesus said the word of God was needed, how much more do you and I? Listen, remember, it's likened unto food, isn't it? You say, well, Pastor, I don't remember a lot of the sermons you give. They're forgettable, maybe. Let's put it that way. They're forgettable, aren't they? But you know, I got thinking about that, and I heard this put years back. I thought it was very helpful for me. That is very true. I'm a very forgettable preacher, okay? And that's okay. But let me just say to you one thing. You have lived your life, and I've lived my life. I'm 43 years old. I've not missed too many meals. And you're Baptist, so you haven't either, okay? Let's not play any games here today. All right? We haven't missed too many meals around here. But you couldn't begin to tell me all those meals you've eaten in over those decades of your life, could you? But all you know is this. They may not have been the best meals, they may not have been the worst meals, but they sustained you to the present, amen? And in the same way today, we can't look back and say all the sermons, all the times we read and studied, but it's what sustains you and you're here today because something's upheld you. And so you think about the strength and the support and the nourishment we get from the consistent study of God's Word. Let me say the Word of God is vital, but secondly, we also see in the context of today's series and sermon, and that is the local church and the importance thereby cannot be overstated. It cannot be overstated. You need a local church to be a part of, period. You need to say, that is my church. That is my church. I'm a part of that church. Now look, I get that you may visit other churches, may visit for special occasions. You may be looking for a church currently, but I would say you need to pray and find a Bible teaching, Bible preaching, Great Commission fulfilling local church that you can be a part of and commit yourself, get into the body, you're part of that body, and serve the Lord through the assembly of the local church. What is God doing today? He's doing it through the local church. And this is so vitally important. If you're not a part, you need to get to be a part. Get connected. If it's not this church, find a Bible teaching, Bible preaching church that loves you enough to speak the whole entire truth of God's word to you and get plugged in that local church. Otherwise, you will be what we said it often. A Christian cannot be in the will of God and out of church. If you're a Christian, you cannot be in the center of God's will and be out of church. It doesn't work that way. You're living in disobedience. And so find a church, get plugged in. Now look, if you're looking for a perfect church, you don't own it because then it's no longer perfect. Amen. You're not going to find a perfect church. You're not going to find a perfect pastor. You're not going to find a perfect leadership. You're not going to find a perfect congregation. You're going to look around and say, yeah, boy, I know that person. I saw them. I know what they... Well, you're going to find that anywhere, right? My family and I don't always get along, but I still love them, right? I still go home to them. They're still my family. I still claim. Sometimes they claim me too. You know what I'm saying? Well, we still love one another. People say, well, that church isn't perfect. Well, think about this. You're going to blame Jesus for the 12 that he had? Those bunch of losers? You know what I'm saying? I mean, you read about the lives of those apostles. You say, boy, couldn't he have picked a better crop of 12? And then one of them he called a devil. Actually, called Peter a devil more on another occasion. But Judas was a deceiver, a betrayer. He deceived and he betrayed them, didn't he? Now, you can't blame Jesus for not having a perfect congregation. Can you blame any local church for not being perfect? There is no perfect church because we're not perfect people, are we? But we have a perfect Savior and we have a perfect holy Word of God. And if we're seeking the Lord, we know the Lord, we can grow in the walk and the work of the Lord. So as we think about this, marks of a healthy church, we're going to look at this further into this study. We'll just kind of briefly introduce it today and share a couple thoughts for you this morning. We find in this passage of 1 Thessalonians that a church has been born. This is significant, especially in the honor of mothers today. Now, I'm blessed today to have my mom with me today. She's still alive. I don't know how, raising four sons, but she's still alive. You think us four boys were the worst. Putting up with my dad, I think, is the worst, you know. And if you know my dad, you know that's not far off, you know. But my mom, what a blessing it is to still have my mom and to think about who she is. You know, she was one of five children. She had no sisters. She had four younger brothers. And I'm not just saying any type of boys. Her maiden name was Garrison. They were the orneriest of the bunch. You have like depraved, right? We're all depraved before God. They were more depraved, okay? They were the type that you lay down to take a nap after a Thanksgiving meal, you know, and you're You woke up to the wet willy in the ear. That was the kind of guy. They could not let you rest, you know. My poor grandfather, before he passed and went to be with the Lord, he'd sleep. And when he'd start to sleep, he'd kick back on the recliner and he'd go. You know what they'd do? They'd go over and find a spoonful of butter and they'd plop it down in his mouth. And he woke up to, you know, a mouthful. But that's the kind of brothers that she had. You know, it's amazing my mom's still alive with those four brothers. I'd go over there as a little boy to my grandmother's side, and they'd see me, and they were so ornery. They'd take me, they'd hang me. They're real big, strong, strapping guys, and they'd take me, and they'd take me by my jeans and my belt, and they'd take this little squirrely kid, and they'd hang me up on the doorknob, you know, like this. My little legs were just kicking away, you know, and they wouldn't let me go. They'd sit there and just laugh and laugh and laugh. That's the brothers my mom grew up, you know, around. She surely thought, surely God will give me a daughter. Heard my dad get married 19 out of high school and get married, and not too long into their marriage, they started a family, and my older brother Nick was born and named after dad. And then I was second, you know, and so they were fine. I had two boys, all right? Well, two boys is enough, right? She had four brothers, and surely God would give her a daughter, right? And so the first two, I think they were okay to have two boys, and then they wanted a girl. And so they prayed for a girl, and they sought for a girl, and then Josh came along. They were going to give up. And they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed, and they wanted a girl. They thought, we'll try one more time. We're getting up in years. We've already got three boys. We'll try one more time. And God gave them the nearest thing to a daughter when he gave them Jared. You know what I'm saying? And so, basically, Jared's the nearest to the daughter as they ever got. You know, I said that in early service. And Jared said, no, it was just perfection. They completed the whole lot when they had me. And I said, well, that's probably somewhat true, maybe in your mind. And so, they had four boys. And so, I watched that, you know, and then giving birth to those and then raising them. And then those four boys, you know, grew up. We all got married and have families of our own. My older brother, Nick, is... he and Joy have had eight kids. One they lost. They have seven children. Sarah and I have four children. And Josh and Candace have four girls. All right, so maybe they didn't get any daughters, but they got several daughter-in-laws and four girls just from one lot, you know. And then Jared, of course, he and Bridget have got three children as well. So they got a whole house full. You know, you're talking about a quiver. They've got a very large quiver. And that there's joy in that, isn't there? There's joy in the new conception. There's joy in the new birth. I saw where one of the families that we'd had some ministry and connection with, the Martindale family, they had a little baby over the night, and the joy that, you know, just kind of watching that journey and giving birth to that. And there's joy in that little life. You know, that little naked blob of flesh comes out, you know, blood all over and screaming and, you know, crying. Don't look like anybody at first. Looks like some alien from outer space, you know, but mom and dad love them, you know. There's some babies that only a mama could love, you know what I'm saying? But some of those babies come out that way. But there's joy in that. There's joy in a new birth. There's gratefulness and gratitude. You prayed for that life, right? You've given, you sacrificed, you prepared. There's a lot that's going into that. And you think about the joy that comes. I'll never forget when Sarah and I got married, we were praying for children. I didn't know if I'd ever have any children. I didn't deserve any children the way I'd lived my life. But by God's grace, God bless us with conception and been married a couple years, and the baby was on the way. We live in this little two-bedroom house. You could sit in one place in the house, see the whole house, you know, one of those kind of houses, and about a mile away. And it was a Sunday afternoon, and she started contracting really bad. It was the first one, didn't really know what to expect. And so she started contracting, and so we went to the hospital, and we were there, and she just was having nonstop contractions. We were tracing up and down the hallways, you know, and trying to work that baby out, bounce that baby out, whatever it was, and it wasn't going to come. About 1:30 in the morning. Kids are always like that, inopportune sometimes, you know. But they come at their own time, right? And about that time, she reached over and she woke me up. We hadn't been asleep very long. She didn't sleep, you know, but us lazy men, you know. She woke me up and time to get up. It's time to go. And so I was all excited. We had our bags already packed. And we only lived a mile away from Clint Memorial Hospital there in Wilmington. And we grabbed our bags and loaded them up in our little blue 1998 Toyota Corolla. Little family car, you know, we had a little seat in the back, we were all ready to go, and there I am, I got my camcorder. It's not like today you're holding this little phone up, all right, it's like this, you know, one of these kind of things, you know, and it was October 8th of 2001, and I'm filming her, It's 1:30 in the morning. Mind you, Wilmington, Ohio is already a dead town. There's nothing going on, all right? We're loaded up, and she's contracting every couple minutes, you know, and we're driving, and I'm filming the whole thing. Her around the house, you know, I'm following her. She's like, you know, she's trying to get ready. I'm just excited, you know. The joy, the birth, you know, it's about to come, you know. We've been waiting for this all this time. We're driving down the road, and I'm like filming everything. Look, there's a full moon up there, you know, and you know, and then you get to the hospital, and you make your way up to the room, and they settle you in, and then you're filming her. And you can watch, it's funny if you go back and watch now, her disposition changes. You know, at first she's just smiling, she's trying to put on a good front, but as footage by footage, this went on for like a long time, 1:30 till 2:30 next afternoon, it started the 12-hour spiral, like 24 hours of constant contraction. So her, she's very sweet, but you could tell her emotions were changing, you know. She wasn't very happy after a while, and so the filming got shorter and shorter, less and less, you know, and she's like, get that thing out of my face, you know. Finally, that afternoon, that Monday afternoon, this little blob of flesh comes out, cone head and all, you know. Big old cone head, hair all over his head, and the joy of that new birth. And I still think back to the joy that we had in that moment and just thanking God for a healthy baby. And just outside the door, I could hear, and it was both mother-in-laws, you know, the grandmothers, right? We're waiting out the door, just ready to come in and see that little precious child. Listen, I say that, and I share all that because there's joy in the birth of a child, isn't there? Now, how much more joy do we find not only with birth of children and motherhood, but we think also today about the birth of a church? You don't often think about that, but let me say to you, just as we are grateful for a new life, we need to be grateful for the local church. Without the local church, where would you be today? We don't think about the significance. I hope through this series you begin to understand the gratitude that we should have for the local church and the significance thereby. Let's talk a little bit about 1 Thessalonians. Paul was a missionary, preacher, pastor. He was one who was saved out of religion, saved unto the Lord Jesus Christ. He covers up the second half of the book of Acts. The first half is the Apostle Peter. The second half is the Apostle Paul. He's a missionary, isn't he? Acts 13, he's called to go out, and as he goes out on his missionary journeys, three different missionary journeys, he goes to many different cities, and by God's grace and his Holy Spirit and a team of them, planted many different churches. Churches in Philippi, churches in Ephesus, churches in Corinth and Galatia and Thessalonica. And then later on in the New Testament, we find that there are letters called epistles. Epistles. What's an epistle? It's the wife of an apostle. You knew that, didn't you? The apostles are the males and the epistles are the females. No, I'm just teasing, all right? The epistles are the letters, all right? See if you're listening. The epistles are the letters that the apostles wrote back to these churches. So in the book of Acts, we read about many different churches that were founded, were birthed, were planted, and then later on, Paul would write back to them, those that he helped to plant and found, and he would encourage them and strengthen them in the Lord. And this is the fulfillment of the Great Commission. This is the fulfillment of Acts 1, verse 8. It was to go to Jerusalem and Judea, Samaria, the uttermost part of the earth, and to take the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, it always begins locally, spreads out regionally, and then it goes internationally. And it always begins in that local city. Can I say to you, my local city was Wilmington, Ohio. I was not from the stinky, God-forsaken town. I was from Wilmington, Ohio, in that Clinton County area. But we never could find a church. There was not any good churches that were there in that community. But in 1995, God brought a young man and his wife, Kelly and Teresa McEnery, to our city. And they planted a church. A church was born. And I began to attend within a year of that church. I was still in high school, and I was not where I needed to be. I was not where I needed to be with the Lord. And my girlfriend at the time, we were not where we needed to be. And we came to that church, and it was a skinny little preacher that stood up there, 25, 26-year-old preacher standing up there. And he'd preach, "Thus saith the Lord." And he'd preach the Word of God with power and conviction. And the Holy Spirit was working mightily through the demonstration of the gospel and of the Word of God. And God got a hold of my heart. And I gave my life to the Lord. My girlfriend got saved. We got baptized there. We got discipled there. It was at that same church that my life was changed. Not anymore was it the same. And at that church is where I got called to ministry. It was at that church that I trained for the ministry to planned pastor a church one day. And I remember Pastor McInerney sitting down with me, and he spent time teaching and training, and week in, week out, he would teach and train us and take time. And whether it was a Thursday night after visitation late or a Saturday morning early, we would take time and study God's Word, knowing that one day we would also pastor. One day we would also plant a church. And God had done that work in my heart. I thought, well, what am I going to do? You know, God's called me into ministry. I can't continue the course of life that I'm going to be in. I'm going to be in full-time ministry. God had put that burden and that call on my life. And so as I began to pray and prepare, and Sarah and I began to pray and prepare and train for the ministry, came on staff there and we're working in a volunteer capacity for a while, then a part-time capacity for a while, then a full-time capacity for a while. And God began dealing in my heart about planting a church. Now, I had no reason to come to Chillicothe for any reason. There was no reason. Junior high, I'll never forget our music teacher standing up in the room stunk. And someone said, what's that smell? He said, oh, it's probably the paper mills from Chillicothe, that stinky town, you know. And I thought, boy, I don't ever want to live there. Here I am, a 13-year-old kid, and I don't want to live there, a stinky place. Man, I wonder if those people smell like that. Then you fast forward a few years and get to this place where God's called me to ministry. My grandfather, my mom's side was a veteran, and he spent about the last year of his life out here at the VA hospital. You think God does things by accident? I don't think so at all. You see, God's sovereign hand was in all those details. As painful as some of that was to watch my grandfather in his last few days of his life, and it was that very thing that brought me to Chillicothe. And then my eyes began looking around, and God began to deal with my heart. Many other things I don't take time to share, but God began to draw my heart to come to Chillicothe to plant a church. I didn't know anybody. Sarah didn't know anybody. So we began to pray and prepare, and we began to pray that God would raise up people, that God would prepare the soil there, that God would bring us people. Listen, before you ever came to this church when we started in 2003, you were prayed for. Maybe not by name, because we didn't know you by name, but we were praying for you. People you'll never meet this side of heaven, we're praying for you. And now should it surprise us that we've intersected? God began to deal in our hearts, and we knew that we were going to plant a church, and Judson came along, and then Sarah got pregnant again the second time when she conceived, and we were moving towards a time of coming, and the time was then, and the pastor told me, he said, well, when she gives birth to your second child, then you go ahead and start. So we began to make preparations, and about a year before that, we had bought some land and built a house, and we had this nice house there and had a nice, comfortable place working there. We were a few miles from her family and from mine, and we could hunt and fish, and we knew everything. We were in our comfort zone. We didn't really want to leave that. But God says, I've got plans for you somewhere else. Never forget when we began to make those final preparations, we thought, well, it's going to take a few months to sell the house, put the sign in the yard. 3 days later, it sold. I said, uh-oh, we're not ready to go yet. She's still got the baby. She's great with child, right? And so we can't go just yet. So we came over to here, and we bought a house while we were still working there. We weren't going to start the church till August of 2003, and this was like early May, and so we bought a house on Mingo Road, and we put our stuff there, and we still live with my mom and dad for about 5 or so days a week, and then we'd come over here a day or two a week and kind of keep the yard mowed and keep things satisfied that way, and we kind of bounced back and forth for 6 weeks, staying with my mom and dad, and that's awkward after you got, a little baby, and you got your stuff squeezed in one little room again, and then, it's just weird, And so here we are, praying, we're preparing, and then it comes that point where she gives birth to our second and bring that little baby girl home from the hospital, and it was time to start. We didn't know anybody. We got a wife and two little babies there in the house, 20 months old and a few days old, and I don't know the first soul here. It's like, you can say you're called to ministry, you can say you're called to start a church, and you don't know a soul. And you've just given everything up, and you moved over, and you bought a house, and you got a wife, two babies. I never forget walking out to take the trash out to the road one night, and I remember thinking, what in the world did I just do? We haven't had a single service. I don't know a soul in this godforsaken, stinky town, and I probably smell just the same. What did I just do? Gave up everything, sold a new house, gave up everything in a nice, large church to come over here and don't have anything to show for it just yet. So the baby would come home, and Sarah's there with the two babies, and we go out and we start knocking doors. We start inviting folks to come, and we did that for about a month. And then in August 3rd, 2003, at the Riverview Conference Center, the Christopher Inn, we had our first afternoon service at 2 o'clock. Not counting us four, there were 17 other people. So 21 people made up the nucleus of Lighthouse Baptist Church on that very first Sunday. There were 92 total, 71 from Wilmington's church came to support us to fill the room. But that only lasted for a few weeks. For five Sundays afternoons, we had service. And the first Sunday of September, we launched the church on a regular slate of services, and Marvin Shaw showed up for a coffee mug. I think I should never have given out coffee mugs if I knew it would have brought Marvin in. You know what I'm saying? Just teasing. He was in the service. I was teasing him there. But from that time till now, God has done a tremendous and amazing work. And I would say to you that a church was born. And there was joy in that church. And I've seen how God has worked amazing ways and miraculous ways. And you realize that you are here today because someone somewhere prayed for you. Someone somewhere. I think about this little old lady, Mammy. I think about Mammy, and she lived in Blanchester, Ohio. She was in her 90s. She could no longer go to church. She wasn't physically able to go. And before I left, I went and prayed with her and met with her and stuff. And she said, I just want you to know that I've been praying for you and Sarah and your kids. And she said, I'm praying for that church over there. She's obviously since going to be with the Lord, but there's a little 90-some-year-old widow in Blanchester, Ohio that was praying for you. You think you're here by accident? There's no accident in this whatsoever. God was working in our hearts, God was working in our lives, and God was working on this end. God was preparing the soil, and then God brings it all together. No, maybe God didn't bring you those first few weeks of the church. Maybe in the last almost 18 years, God has brought you to cross paths with us, and then not only to see what God's done here, but then to reproduce that and give birth to a church in Xenia. Lighthouse Baptist Church in Xenia runs hundreds and hundreds of people every Sunday that started out of this church in 2009. 2017, the Lighthouse Baptist Church in Circleville, Brother Nathan Lord, phenomenal preacher, amazing preacher, preached circles around anyone I know, pastoring away in Circleville, Ohio. Great work of God going on there. Brother Matt Stallings called the ministry through the ministries here, pastoring at the First Baptist Church in Ashland, Ohio. As I speak, he's preaching to the gospel of Jesus Christ to people up there. He came to this church. He was working at Sam's Club. Eric and Ashley Woodworth, teenagers that came to our church unsaved. He was an atheist. He got saved. She got saved. They got baptized. They got married, discipled, called to ministry. They're missionaries in Honduras as we speak. Can I say to you, Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth, when a church is born, glorious things happen. A church and giving birth to churches is what churches are called to do. I realize many don't do that, but that is the nucleus of what we see in the New Testament. Oh, my friend, there's so much prayer and sacrifice that goes in. You think about this. Does a child fully understand the work, the sacrifice that went into them being in this world? Do they understand what it meant for them to be raised up for 18 years in a home to have every need ever met? They don't fully understand. When will they understand? When they do it themselves. When they have a family of their own, then they'll begin to realize, man, Mom and Dad, they made a lot of sacrifices, you know. There's not much you can say beforehand. They'll just realize on the back end of just how much sacrifice. And so here on Mother's Day, I say to you, there's joy in the birth of a new life. And today I say there's joy in the birth of a new church. My friend, we need churches that are Bible teaching, Bible preaching, healthy churches. We see today in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, if you look there with me, beginning in verse number 1, what makes up a healthy church? You say, what are the marks of a healthy church? You know, there's 300-some thousand churches in America. How do you know when you find a good one? How do you know that that's one you should join? What are some good indicators of that? We need healthy churches. While the world is going woke, the church is going asleep. We need to see churches that have health and vibrancy and indicate faithful beacons of hope in these treacherous days in which we live. Paul writes these words to the church at Thessalonica, a church that he, Silvanus or Silas and Timothy helped to found. Now this church was founded in Thessalonica. We read about them in Acts chapter 17, if you go back there with me. In Acts 17 and verse number 1. They founded it on the second missionary journey. They would come to an area, and Paul, as we see his custom was, would go to the synagogue and preach, and those would respond, and the church would be founded, and the church would be birthed, and great joy would be had. Paul was so grateful and thankful for this church, as we'll look at. Thessalonica is still a city today. It's known today as Thessaloniki. So how do you know that? Well, I listened on YouTube. I didn't say it quite as profound as they said it. Thessaloniki, you know. But Thessalonica, it's still a city. And you say, well, how do we know the Bible is true? Well, here you go, all right? Here's one example. The church was founded in Thessalonica 1,900 plus years ago. They're still a city today, Thessalonica. They're just one smallest of detail. You got to answer. I've got an answer for it. The church of Thessalonica was founded on the second missionary journey, and we find in Acts 17, let's read about the founding, the birth of this church. Notice in Acts 17, verse number 1, Paul had already been on the second missionary journey. They came to Philippi, and in Philippi, remember, they came there because of the Macedonian call. The Lydia was one of those that got saved, and others. We find in Acts 16 that the young maiden girl was possessed. And Paul turned around and cast a demon out of her, and her masters were upset because they were making money, profiting off of her. They throw them in jail after beating them. And while in jail that night, they sang praises at midnight, and that place really began to rock, reel, and roll, amen? And the door swung open. The jailer was going to commit suicide, and Paul said, don't harm yourself, we're all here. The jailer gets saved, his wife and household get saved. They get baptized. How? Because they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and were saved. They go on from Philippi, and they come to this area of Thessalonica, Thessaloniki today, all right? Verse number 1, now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. Verse number 2, and Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, is Christ. Verse 4, and some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks, a great multitude, and the chief women, not a few. Verse 5, but the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort. This is how some of you lived before you got saved, right? You were a lewd fellow of the baser sort. Gathered a company and set all the city on an uproar and assaulted the house of Jason, who was housing these believers, and sought to bring them out to the people. In verse 6, and when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren of the rulers of the city, crying, these men that have turned the world, what? Upside down are come hither also. Verse 7, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Jesus. In verse number 8, and they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. And verse number 9, and when they had taken security of Jason of the other, they let them go. And what do we find? You read on to verse 10 down to verse 15 and you'll find this. Paul was pressed out of that city. The city turned in an uproar. Why? Because they were wholly given idolatry and false religion. And Paul and company come to town and they preach the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And people get saved and turn from idols to serve the living and the true God. And the city is turned upside down. They say the world is turned upside down. What is their testimony? They say that the testimony is this. They're not serving King Caesar. They're serving King Jesus. 2 things they knew about them. They turned their world upside down, and they were giving praise to King Jesus. The Jews, those lewd fellows of the baser sort, and the whole city that was turned against them, put the pressure, and Paul moved on by the providence of God to the next city. And he comes into Berea, then on to Athens. And in Athens, Timothy and Silas catch up. And Paul's concerned because he was only with them for less than a month. And these people who got saved, these people who turned unto the Lord, how were they doing? How was this new church doing? This fledgling little congregation. I mean, if you could only minister to a church for a month, come into town, preach messages for 3 weeks in a row, and a host of people get saved, and a church is quickly formed and taught what they could be in a month, and then you had to be rushed out of town because the whole town turned on you. How do you think they'd be doing? Paul comes over in the book of Thessalonica, we read about it, and he says, I'm concerned for you. I was worried about you, and so I sent Timothy back. From Athens, Paul sent Timothy back to them to check on them, to confirm them, to commend them. And then later on, we find in 1 Thessalonians 3, 1-7, that Timothy comes back with a good report. They're doing well. They're healthy. They're strong. They're vibrant. And Paul writes this letter back to them. He is enthusiastic. He is praising God. He is thankful. Why? Because a church was there. A church was established. A church was born. And the work that he did was not in vain. So I say to you today these couple thoughts. Verse number 1, as you pick up there in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse number 1. Notice as he gives the salutation, he speaks about the company of missionaries. Paul, Silvanus, or Silas, and Timothy unto the church of the Thessalonians. This church that was birthed, he says this, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father. Can I say to you, notice the order there, grace and peace. Listen, notice it doesn't say peace and grace, because without grace there is no peace. And you can't get peace without grace. You can't have one without the other. If there's no grace in your life, there's no peace in your life. But if you know grace in your life, then you know peace in your life. Have you received the grace of God? Then you have the peace with God. If you don't have any grace of God through Jesus Christ, you don't know any peace. So what do we know about this church that's born? What are the marks of a healthy church? Oh, my friend, we see number one, it must be a people of prayer. Verse number two goes on to say, we give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers. They were a praying church. Paul prayed for them. They were praying for one another. Can I say to you, if a church is going to be a healthy church, it must be a praying church. They must seek the Lord. They must make petitions unto God. Samuel said, it's a sin that I would not pray for you. We need to pray for one another. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. Prayer is vital in all the church and all the ministries and all for one another and for each other. Oh, my friend, what a blessing it is to know that when you have a burden, when you're carrying a need, you don't have to carry it alone. You can bring that petition to the church family, to the body of Christ, and find others will pray for you. You're not alone. How encouraging it is to have someone come alongside of you and say, I'm praying for you. I love you. I care for you. I care for the burdens that you carry in life. You don't have to carry them alone. To think that someone is interceding on your behalf, the prayer bulletin we give out, the prayer that is made as people share needs on different venues and social media, and to know that people are praying instantly at any given day of time or night, they are praying. Oh, my friend, we need to be a people of prayer. And a church that's going to be a healthy church must be, as we find in verse number two, making mention of you in our prayers. And then secondly, and finally, is a people of gratitude. A people of gratitude. Oh, my friend, we need to be people who are grateful. You know, we're not a very grateful people, are we? We live in days and times where we take so much for granted. And you may be here today and you say, well, I kind of take this church for granted. Or I take the opportunity to come this morning for granted. You know, if it's not here, it's just somewhere else. Oh, my friend, you really miss out. You never stop to think about how many Christians are scattered all over this globe who don't have a local church like this to come to. You see, it's not until you don't have it that you really begin to appreciate what you do have. And I saw growing up where we did not have a Bible teaching, Bible preaching church that was concerned about the souls of mankind, that was concerned about my soul and my condition. Oh, my friend, we grew up when we were wandering about, lost sheep, darkness covered our lives, and we were distraught and dismayed, and our lives were going anywhere but what God wanted them to go. Yet it was that skinny little preacher and his wife that came to our town that began to say, thus saith the Lord, that began to preach the gospel to us, that began to uphold the Great Commission. And God used the ministry of that local church that was birthed in my hometown to transform my life. Can I say to you, I can't be grateful enough for the ministry of a local church. I would not be here today. I would not be the husband that I am today. I would not be the father that I am today had it not been for a local church that was born in my town. Can I say to you, I don't know where all you were before here. I'm not saying God only used this church in your life, but one way or another, if you've been here any length of time, God has used this ministry in your life in some way. And if you got saved here, if you got further growing and sanctified here, your life has been blessed by this ministry. Now, you may not love everything about the church, but I'm going to say you need to think about how much God has used this church in your life. There's been countless people saved, many of which have already gone to be with the Lord. You ever think about how significant it was that that church was planted in Thessalonica? How significant it is planted here? How many of you today are now saved and your spouse is saved and your parents are saved, your kids are saved, your grandkids are saved? They're being raised up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Or maybe that wasn't the case prior to a church like this being planted, but prior to a church like this being born. And what does Paul say in verse number three? He says in verse number two and three, we give thanks to God always for you all. You all, you would say y'all, right? We give thanks to God for you, always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Listen, my friend, you may not fully grasp or fully comprehend or understand what difference this kind of ministry makes in your life, but my friend Paul recognized the impact it made. I could assure you those people in Thessalonica who were unsaved on their way to hell and then come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and are saved forevermore. Oh, their eternity will tell the difference of a church being born. We need to be a people of gratitude, thankful for the church, thankful for the leadership, thankful for one another, thankful that we have a place to come and gather and, yes, be preached to, spit on, and loved. Amen. We need to have a place where we can come and pray for one another and witness alongside and support missionaries and raise our children and grandchildren up in the ways of the Lord. Thank God for a ministry like this. We pray that God would do a work here. But I know people on the other end praying too. There's people in the church now that prayed for this church to come. They didn't know my name. They didn't know me. They didn't know anyone else. But they knew that this city needed a church like this. One of those men was George Carroll. For the first several years of the church, George Carroll led our singing. George Carroll was a soul winner. George Carroll lived his life knocking the doors of this town, winning people to Jesus Christ. And he was praying that God would raise up a Bible-teaching, Bible-preaching, soul-winning, evangelistically-minded church. God allowed him to see it before he went to heaven. You know what? You're a byproduct of people like George Carroll who prayed and faithfully came and gave this skinny 25-year-old, dark-haired, back in those days, and my wife, 23, we looked like we were 19 and 17 or something. She still looks 17. I just look like I'm 67, all right? He gave us a chance. I'll never forget, we put this little advertisement in the paper. It said, exciting new church now forming. Buzz Eisler and George Carroll were friends and neighbors and both saw us. Did you see that? Yeah, we saw that. Let's go check it out. Sure enough, they both did. Almost 18 years later, George is since going to be with the Lord, but Buzz is still faithfully here with his family. You know who came as a result of that? This 97, almost 98-year-old man down here, Stanley Lee. I'll tell you what, this church is here because someone like that was praying. There's many people in this room today that prayed for a church like this. Maybe didn't even know what they were fully praying for, but praying for a closer walk with the Lord. And God sovereignly and providentially brought these whole things together. God doesn't work by accident. He brought it all together for such a time as this. And Paul was grateful for this church. He thanked God for this church. He said in chapter 2 and verse number 13, he says, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing because you received the word of God. Verse 19, you are our hope and joy and crown of rejoicing. He said it again in 3:9. We thank God and render to God again thanks for you and the joy that you bring to our hearts. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, in everything we should give thanks. My friend, if in everything we should give thanks, how much more when we realize of the ministry of a church like this? It's not perfect, but it's a place that your soul is being cared for. And can I say to you, you're not getting that in the world. People love you and pray for you. Can I just say to you, if you're a part of this church, every week, your name is being called out to God. I know others are praying for you, but I know myself. I'm calling you out to God by name. Every one of you, I'm calling out by name every week. And people are shepherding your soul. Can I say to you, put a price tag on that. Is anybody at Walmart or the company you work for, are they praying over your soul? Are they concerned about your sanctification? Are they concerned about your kids' salvation? You see, someone who says, I love you enough to come, to plant the church, to start the church, to preach to you, to care for you. We started the church, I'll never forget, we hadn't been here real long, and we were in a little dinosaur building on Bridge Street, a little vacant, rundown, former propane gas dealership. Been an old rundown, vacant building. They were going to tear it down. It's now Menards parking lot. We met in that little building, I'll never forget, it was not maybe a year or so in, and the family came to visit. There were two ladies, a mother and her daughter. They sit out there very prim and proper. I was up there, didn't know what I was doing then anymore, and I probably do now. Just preaching away, doing all that I knew to do. But they kept coming. I remember visiting them, following up with them, and then this scraggly old guy came in one Sunday. Gangly old fella. Randall Browning. Shane was on drugs. Shane had been a drug dealer in this town when we started the church. But he came to church and he kept hearing and kept hearing and kept hearing. He saw the witness of his wife and he got saved. Then he got baptized. Then he got disciple. And I never gave much hope, but God sure did. God took a chance on him. We took a chance on him. We poured into his life, and he got saved, and he got right with God, and his life's never been the same. He's not the man he used to be, not the husband he used to be. He loves his wife, and he's raising 5 godly kids, 2 of which he adopted. You tell me God isn't working in lives. This is a man that's changed. He goes in schools every week. He's led more people to Christ in his community than anyone I could name. A church was born. And if for no other reason, one man was saved to be a husband and his wife, raise 5 godly kids. You tell me the difference a church makes. It changes lives and it saves souls and it changes destinies and it changes generations. And his mom and daddy got saved and now his boys are saved and they're going to live for the Lord Jesus Christ. You tell me the church being born doesn't make a difference. I'll tell you it does every time. We ought to be grateful for the ministry of a church. And now he goes into the schools and he's preaching the gospel to these kids. He's giving them a chance that he didn't have when he was a teenager. Telling you, my friend, when you find a local church that loves the Lord and loves people and pours the gospel and teaches the whole counsel of God's word, you get plugged in that church and you love that church and you serve that church. You're a part of that body. Would you stand with me today? I can't preach anymore. I'm spitting and slobbering. My friend, there's nothing so intoxicating as seeing God change lives. And that happens through the power of the gospel and through the power of his word. Power of people being obedient and surrendered to the Lord. My friend, God may not call you to be a church planter, but God has called all of us to himself. God has called all of us to serve the Lord, to find a church to get plugged into. God has dealt in your heart today. I would invite you to come. You're not sure that you're saved. I invite you to come. If you're here today, my friend, you have been saved. Maybe you're here, you're not fully surrendered. You're not giving yourself over to the Lord. Oh, my friend, have you given thanks for this church? No, it's not perfect. We fail you. We always will be. But Jesus' disciples failed him. He didn't give up. Was he a failure? No. We press on. We love the Lord. We serve the Lord. We serve one another. How many of they would come today as God deals in your heart? If you need to make a decision, you need to serve the Lord. We had one in the early service that said, I want to come and join with this church. If you're not plugged into a church, at some point, my friend, you're outside the will of God. You need a local church to get plugged in. And when you find it, serve. It's not perfect, but get plugged in and serve. That's a body you've been called to. Lord, bless this invitation time. May your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you come today as we sing and have a time of invitation as God deals in hearts? If you need to be saved, would you come? Need to be baptized? Would you come? Need to join with this church? If God's laid on your heart, if he hasn't, don't come. But if he's called you to come, would you come? As the altar is full, would you come today? If you need to make a decision, would you come today as we sing? Would you come?
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God! Sing with me.
Heads where you're at. Maybe you just want to come and thank God for what he's done in your life. Thank God for those preachers and Christians and churches and brothers and sisters in Christ that have helped you to get to where you're at today. If God's dealt today in your heart, would you come? You need to make a decision. Whatever it is, would you step out today and come? If you're not sure that you're saved, today's the day to come. My friend, you need Christ. Would you come? He'll save you today. There's no one that's too far gone. Myself, yourself, we heard Brother Shane's testimony. God can transform your life through his power. Let's sing to another verse as these pray. You're welcome to come today.
Age to age he stands, and time.
saved today, would you come? As others come today, if you need to step out, he'll save you. There's altar workers here that would share Christ with you. You need to be saved, need to make a decision. Whatever it is, would you come today? As we say,
how great is our God? Sing with me, how great.
God's dealt in your heart today, would you come? Balcony or main floor, whatever it may be, would you come? Still going on, isn't it? God's not finished with us. And you know, I've let you down as a church. You know that I know that I've not been a perfect pastor, but I thank God that he's not given up. Amen. He's not called us home yet. Rapture hasn't taken place. We're still here, and God's still giving us time. My friend, a journey of 1,000 steps begins with one. Whatever that one step is for you to take today, I encourage you to take that step. Please hang around and talk to any of the staff. We'd be happy to sit down and share with you. You need to make a decision. All of God's people said, amen. Church has been born. Amen. You may be seated today. As you're seated, and if I can have the ushers come behind you, give back a portion of that which God has entrusted to you. Just share a few announcements. If you got a bulletin, I'll highlight just a couple things. Again, happy Mother's Day to all the ladies that are out there today. And we thank God for you. Be back tonight, 6 o'clock. We'll continue our series, Marks of a Healthy Church. Wednesday night, something for all ages. LBC Kids Club is having their store night, teen ministry meets, and Gospel Luke Wednesday night, 6:30. Next Thursday, this coming Thursday, is the Primetime Senior Fellowship. Senior Saints there, all right. You know what age that is, all right. We generally kind of say the 50s are up, 55 are up, whatever. You figure that out. We're not calling you old, we're saying Senior Saints, all right. Jackson 4 Mile Greenhouse and Bakery Trip, meet at the church at 9 a.m. It's a great chance to get together with some great brothers and sisters in Christ and have the joy of the Lord and fellowship one with the other. This Thursday, see Nick or Cindy Bevan for more on that. Next Saturday is the Ladies Conference. It's at Bible Baptist Wilmington. Ladies are going to meet at the church at 7 and return around 3:30. You can ride there. We'll have some church vans, or you can follow along, or you can meet there if you like. But they're going to meet here at the church and then head over this coming Saturday at 7. Outreach is at 10 and visitation. And the next Sunday, we'll continue our Mark of the Healthy Church. Also, just in 2 weeks from today, high school and college graduates, please let us know. We'd like to recognize you Sunday morning, May 23rd. Please let Brother Shane know there. If you're graduating, so we don't miss anyone. Then also the ballpark night, Sunday evening, May the 30th. All right, we're going to have a great time there of tennis, baseball, all right? I can't play baseball very well, but you get a big old tennis racket and a tennis ball. You know, it's kind of hard to miss that, you know what I'm saying? And so we'll have a great time of food and fellowship there. Sunday, May 30th. Bible school's coming up this summer. Junior high school camp, junior camp. Going to have a great summer. Looking forward to what God's going to do. And again, thank the Lord. Last Sunday, we had Evangelist Tim Lee in. Had 27 folks get saved. We had one baptized last Sunday. Two more Wednesday night. Some more that are planning to here coming up. So we're just thanking the Lord for each and every one of those decisions. So let's pray today. Ask God's blessing on the offering. And if you're visiting, take a moment. Fill out that visitor card. Just drop it there in the place that comes by. Kyle Bennett, would you pray for us? Thank you. Let's close out with a word of prayer. So thankful that a church was born in my town, and the church's been born here and been able to help birth and plant several other churches. And we want to continue that long term as the Lord will tarry and give us the ability and the people and the resources to do so. Let's close out today with a word of prayer. Stanley Lee, would you mind praying for us?